Hello, everyone, and welcome. So great to see you all on the eve of spring and on the eve of the plethora of birdsong that's about to be ringing all around us in our environment. I know I just heard my first bird call last week. It was a northern cardinal, and that to me is usually the harbinger of spring. So hopefully this presentation today will give you the same love I have for hearing that song. My name is Andy Jarema, like Joanna said. I'll talk a little bit more about myself in a second, but first, let's jump in, everybody. Here we go.
You know I'm birding, baby.
Bird song.
Where my binoculars at?
Bird song.
I'm with the trees.
Bird song.
I'm looking for birds, yo.
Bird song.
So, today's presentation is going to be a lot of fun and very interactive, but also hopefully very informative. So be prepared to be mentally engaged as well as engaged with your art. And we're going to talk about that in a second. But before we start anything else, I wanted for us all to sort of sit and meditate on this quote for a second. So I'm just going to let you silently read it to yourself and just sort of meditate on this. So I don't know what truth Kurt Cobain was talking about here, and I don't know what truth sort of came into your mind. But for me, as a person who loves the natural world, my truth is that we are living in an age of a biodiversity crisis, and we have, and for a long time. And it's not possible to do a joyous celebration of birdsong and music without acknowledging that. It's not a possibility, right? So I wanted to frame my entire presentation with the idea that, again, we are losing the natural world. That is the sort of age we live in and have to contend with. And so even though, again, today's going to be joyous, we're going to be talking about the joy of listening to birds and how it relates to music. This will be a minor theme throughout today's presentation. So keep that as sort of a dome over all that we're going to be talking about today. And again, that's sort of why I love to talk about this, because I care so much about the natural world and sort of fighting back against the biodiversity crisis that we're all experiencing. So real quick, this is me. I'm Andy Jarema. I live in Michigan, in the Metro Detroit area, and I'm many things. First and foremost, I'm a teacher. I got my training as a music educator in my undergraduate degree in college, but I'm also a composer. That's the other split half of my identity. And I love to create things, usually with natural sounds. So of course, that path eventually led me to this presentation today, birdsong, because as someone who loves natural sound, I think it's some of the most virtuosic and melodious sounds there is in the natural world. And just a really brief overview of what we're going to be doing today. So it's broken into three parts. I have no idea if we're going to get to the third part because I stuffed the second part with so much stuff. So we'll see if we get there. Great if we do, great if we don't. But part one is going to be developing your techniques for hearing individual birds. And I'm going to hopefully train you enough so that you can walk out your front door and at least start the process of doing that yourself, because it's tough. It's really tough. And then in part two, we're going to test that knowledge. We're going to put those techniques to work with a few quizzes I have lined up for you. And then interspliced with that is going to be some really interesting facts about birdsong. And then for the third part, again, if we get there, we're going to be artistically responding to one particular bird, because there's a lot of artists in the room today, and I want you all to be able to respond to a bird in your own sort of medium. I will be taking big pauses for questions in between the parts, and I will signal to you when those like pauses happen for questions. So save your questions for then. If you have like a quick, like, I don't understand that, or can you please like clarify what you want here, Andy? That's fine. But if you have like a deeper question or thing to discuss, save it for those moments, because I'm going to open up space for any and all good questions out there. Okay. And again, I probably won't answer them like, you know, anywhere else in the presentation. And then if we do end up getting to part three, real quick, I just want to send this out in the chat. That's a Google Drive link to some sound files. If there's any musicians out there who love manipulating audio on their computer, there are some sound files for you of the recordings I'm using in part three. So that's only if you are a digital audio person like me and would love to play around with the actual recording itself. Otherwise, all you other artists out there, make sure you have pen and paper, instrument, whatever you're going to respond to Birdsong with, because we're going to use it a lot in part three. Okay. Last thing. Okay, so if you are able to, I'm going to be doing a few things where you might annotate today. So give me a giant scribble really quick if you can annotate. If you can't, or you're not able to because certain devices can't for some reason, or maybe you're in a car, Rodney, I totally don't want you annotating. Please don't. But everyone else who can annotate, give me a scribble right now on my screen so I know that you can do it. And if anyone has questions about the annotating, now would be a great time to jump in. Let me know if you have a question about the annotating, like, help, never done this before. Thank you, Alexis. I got Joanna scribbling there. I see another scribble there. Awesome, awesome.
Yeah, could I actually get help on the how to annotate?
Yeah, no problem, Akari. So if you're on a phone, it might not have it. I don't really understand it. It's something to do with Zoom. But if you're on a desktop or any other computer, if you like go up to where it says, I think it'll say like Nomadic Soundsters is screen sharing, or maybe it'll say my name, Andy Jarema, screen sharing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that drop down menu, if you click on the pen or the pencil.
Oh, it should hopefully work.
Yay. All right, we are, hey, there's Akari's orange annotation there. Look at that. Cool.
Also, yeah, and additionally, at least for my desktop, ooh, big scribble. There's a little pen sort of like icon on the lower left hand corner that you can just click on as well, for some of you.
Thank you, Joanna, because it's always in a different place and I never know where to tell people to look, so that might have helped someone, so thank you. And again, if you can't scribble, it's not a big deal, but it'll be more fun if you can. So I've planned a few things with that today. All right, everyone. So I need to get rid of your lovely drawings here. I'm so sorry. And it's time to begin part one officially. So here we go. So, if I asked all of you to tell me what you're hearing right now, you'd probably say what I said when I started really listening to birds, which is I hear birds, right? Because birdsong, if you're not familiar with it, sounds like white noise. Just as I compare this to like when I'm listening to a new genre of music I'm not very familiar with, it just sounds like white noise. It's hard to pick out the details and the elements that you need to really synthesize what it means. And again, this was the experience I found when I walked out my door one day and decided I'm gonna listen to birds like really deeply. But then there was that thicket of white noise and I was just like, I can't tell which is which. But with a little bit of work, you can start picking out the individual sounds. and then you can maybe start to hear those sounds within this thicket again, right? And I compare this process to when someone first pointed out to me that the symphony orchestra is made of the woodwind, brass, string, and percussion families. Or when somebody pointed out to me that, oh, rap and hip hop beats are made of kicks, snares, and hi-hats, right? Once I had that sort of like hat to hang on, I guess, it really helped me understand like those genres, just as with Birdsong, there's a few things you can do to start really parsing apart what you're hearing. And then it becomes fun. Then it becomes the funnest sort of game to walk out your door and see if you can like spot however many bird calls there are at that particular moment. So my goal for you today in this first part is to be able to do that, to parse through that thicket and be able to hear those four different bird calls like I sort of can now. First, we're gonna warm up on one bird, because I'm not going to throw four birds at you and expect you to parse them all out all at once. Let's start easy here. So just take a listen to this recording and get it in your ear. Okay, so some of you might know what this bird is, maybe. If you don't, I'll tell you in a bit. We need to create a sonic token for this bird, something that's going to allow you to remember that sound. And this is where, for me, my experience as a musician came in, and I began to catalog these sounds I was hearing like I would catalog sounds as a musician. So what we're all going to do as a group here is we're gonna go through these terms in the upper right-hand side of my screen and sort of catalog what are you hearing, okay? And we're gonna go through these terms one by one. I want everyone who can to respond. The best ways to do this are gonna be in the chat or with annotations. And again, feel free to go anywhere on my screen. The space is yours to annotate. I don't think with this big of a group we'll have time to answer aloud. Again, the best way to do this is either going to be annotate or do it in the chat. If anyone's not able to, totally fine if you can't. You can just unmute and tell us what you think. Okay? All right, so let's go through these one by one here. I'm going to back up here to pitch contour. Draw it on the screen or write an answer in the chat. So what's our pitch doing here? Is it going up? Is it going down? Is it doing up and down? High to low? And by the way, if you're not sure, or if you're like, what's pitch contour, Andy? You didn't explain that very well. Just take a guess. And a lot of these things I'm going to be throwing at you don't have like necessarily one correct answer. So don't feel like if you're a little bit out of your element here that you like can't answer, right? And by the way, these are some cool illustrations so far on my screen. Look at all this, right? In the chat, I saw downward glissando, and I'm seeing a lot of people agreeing with that answer with their annotations. We sort of have this downward pitch, this eh, right? And I would agree with that. That's what my ear is picking up on too. And that should be the first thing that we sort of use to identify this bird. Okay. Let's go to the next element here. Phrasing or rhythmic pattern. How often is this bird chirping? Quickly? Is there big pauses in between? And any other rhythmic elements you notice? And feel free to annotate, put an answer in the chat, share out loud if you want. If there's anyone who needs to share out loud, by all means, unmute yourself and share loud. Yeah, I see the number two over there. At least I think it's a number two. And I'm seeing what Joanna's annotating over there. I really like that annotation, by the way, Joanna. That's really cool. And I'm kind of agreeing with that, that it kind of comes in pairs of two, right? We have one, two, and there's a silence. One, two, and then there's silence. So that's the sort of rhythm of this bird, right? It kind of has this like, So that's another thing we can listen for when we're picking out this specific bird amongst all the other bird calls we hear. How about timbre? Now this gets really nebulous, right? And for those who don't know, timbre is the tone color of the sound. So in other words, does it sound clear? Does it sound gruff? Does it sound like it has vocal fry? Does it sound like it's, you know, a trumpet? Does it sound like an oboe? What does it sound like? What's the color of the sound? And you can feel free to write like Momilani did there, a big like word cloud there. I love that, Momilani. Nasal. I would definitely agree with that. Yep, it has a very nasal sort of quality. Yes, I would agree with it's a noisier sound. It's less pitchy. And with birds, there sort of is that divide. Like some are very melodious and tonal. Some are very noisy and clanky and metallic. An orange. Ooh, I like that, Kit. And yeah, I wonder, like, to you, like, what these other birds are going to sound like later and what the sort of like forest of sound looks like to you. It's like a synesthetic thing almost, right? So if this is orange, like, what are the other ones? And by the way, Kit, it'll be interesting in a second to compare it to what the bird actually looks like. Like, what is the color of the bird? Is it orange? Does it match its vocal timbre? Onomatopoeia. So this is a technique that birders used back in the day a lot when we didn't have sound recording, right? Like, how do you like transcribe bird song if you're an ornithologist who can't like do sheet music, right? So they would come up with onomatopoeia, like words or phrases to mimic what that bird is saying. So I'm very curious to see if anyone has like some onomatopoeia for this one. Feel free to get goofy with this if you want. Nya, nya, I love that, Kit. Yeah, yeah. That's a good one, Akari. And by the way, I just moved something on my screen to see the lovely answers I didn't see below what was blocking everything here on my screen. The bright and squeaky and not exactly a timbre, but sounds like a baby crow with less fry. I love those answers. I just saw them now. Sorry I didn't see those earlier, right? And yeah, we got a lot of good onomatopoeia. And again, this is a legit technique that birders used to use. And you can even read like old birding manuals. Even newer ones have like quick phrases that like will help you remember what a bird sounds like. So use it. And sometimes that's the best thing you can do. Some of my like, you know, onomatopoeias out there for some of the birds are like my go-to things when I'm trying to identify a bird. And finally, this is probably the most common thing I do. I come up with a cheeky nickname for the sound I'm hearing. So for example, I'll just give you my answer for this one. I call this bird the asshole, pardon my French, because it sounds like a jerk, right? Like, listen to that bird, right? So, and yeah, you can edit that out, Joanna, right? You can censor me if you know, need to keep it squeaky clean for the general public out there when we send this recording out. So does anyone else have a squeaky nickname for this bird? Be curious to know if anyone else comes up with a cheeky nickname. Whiny crow, sure, why not? Whiner, yeah, it does have a whining sort of quality to it, right? Look at that, Momi, Lani, and Joanna came up with the same one right in a row. Preteen whale, oh, that is glorious. I love that, Sammy, because yes, I have taught many age ranges, and that is a preteen whale, that is for sure. Yeah, funny enough, I'm doing my tax returns tomorrow, so yep, that will also be me, Tansy. Yep, absolutely. But right, it has this sort of whining or this sort of like sort of quality to it, right? And I feel like having this sort of like connection to the bird will strengthen your sonic bond to it. It does for me, at least. Like, you know, in my neighborhood, I have a Cardi B bird that sounds like, oh, or I have like DJ bird that sounds like a DJ at the turntables. So these cheeky nicknames can really like help cement for you what these birds are sonically. So use them, right? All right, everyone, so that was the last thing on my list here to help you remember what this bird is. So hopefully now you have a good sonic token for this bird, right? And you can, when you hear it, go, oh, that's the tax return bird, or that's the preteen whale, or that's the bright and squeaky baby crow with less fry bird, or the orange timbre, right? Now though, let's see what this bird is. And before I do that, let's just take one last gander at our lovely drawings here. So I'll clear the screen in a second. Okay, and before I click the next slide, just out of curiosity, does anyone know what this bird is? It's a very common bird, although my California people, it's not in your area, but it is a very famous bird. The blue jay, look at that. So the next time you hear this aggressive preteen whale, you'll know it's the blue jay, right? And again, to me, this is the asshole. And when I hear it, and by the way, even my 18 month old daughter knows this call now, we know exactly what it is. We'll be sitting on our couch being like, yep, that's him. He's complaining about something, right? Now, we're going to be moving closer to letting you get to four birds at once. We really spent some time in this one bird, but we're going to be moving in a second to four different birds. Okay, so be ready to get more sonic tokens at your disposal. But before we do, I want to send out a warning. Birdsong is incredibly tough to pick out sometimes because birds are such good mimics. And this blue jay, for example, makes, I mean, I can't even count the number of sounds it can make, but these are just some of the sounds to just show you how difficult it can be to pin a sound on a bird sometimes. So here's our original blue jay sound. But if you hear this, it's also a blue jay. Or you might hear this sound, which my partner Danielle likens to like a metallic bat hitting a ball. This is also a blue jay. That one's really wild, I think. It's one of my favorite sounds I make. Or you might hear that and think it's a hawk. It's a blue jay. And no one knows exactly why blue jays do this, but it's imitating a red-shouldered hawk. And either it's trying to imitate the bird to scare other birds, or maybe it's warning other birds of something, because hawks usually are bad news for songbirds like this, right? No one knows why, but they can do it. So if you hear that sound and think it's a hawk, it might be a blue jay, right? So I just wanted to quickly throw that out there. It can be really hard. And sometimes it can take me as much as like 2 years to figure out that, oh, that bird song I thought was this is actually that. Like that cowbird in my neighborhood fooled me. I thought it was a dark-eyed junco for years. And then I was like, That's a cowbird. That is not a dark-eyed junco. Look at that. All right, so now we're going to whip quickly through this. Unlike the blue jay where we took lots of time, I'm going to probably play each of these recordings once or twice, and I want you to each create sonic tokens for each of these four birds. And again, feel free to use the things that we talked about earlier with the blue jay: pitch, timbre, rhythmic qualities, onomatopoeia, maybe a nickname. Or I'm also kind of widening the scope here and letting you go wild. So artists out there, if you have like another way you want to like respond to this bird right now, I'm kind of gonna let you open up here, okay? And depending on time, we might have a little time if anyone like really wants to share. Oh yeah, Rodney, I'm not sure if you just unmuted to share something or there's just an accidental press there. Oh, maybe it's accidental. I do that all the time. And sorry, by the way, I see someone unmute and I'm like, wait, does someone have a question? What? So again, I want you to create a sonic token for each of these birds. So come up with a way to remember them, because when we get to part two in a second, you're gonna have to really flex that knowledge, okay? So here's our first bird. And again, I'll probably only play this recording once or twice. So be sure to quickly get something down that makes you remember the bird. And feel free to annotate on my screen, use the chat, write something down on a piece of paper, whatever you need to do. So here's the first bird. So again, this is gonna go pretty quick. If we have more time, I'd play it more times, but just try and get one really quick thing down. And again, put it in the chat, annotate on my screen, or write it in private on your little notebook. Doesn't matter to me, whatever's gonna help you remember. Here's number two. And one more time on number two. So get something down for that one. Here is number three. And number four, our last bird. Okay, so one more time real quick. I'll just whip through all those recordings one last time, just in case you need one more refresher. Here's number one. Number two. Here's number three. And number four. There it is. So hopefully you have some sonic token for yourself, a way to identify that bird, even if it's just one word that you can remember for each of those four. Clutch them tightly, because we're going to need them in part two. But really quick, let's make the eye-ear connection here, because one of the other things that might be obvious, when you're listening for birds, if you can see it and see it making the sound, that really helps, right? So it helps to make that connection. So then when you later just hear the bird, sometimes it conjures the visual imagery even when you can't see it. So the first bird is our lovely house sparrow. And I can guarantee that every one of you is probably mere feet from one of these buddies, because they're on 6 out of 7 continents. And they are one of the most invasive songbirds out there. And the reason for this is because they shifted their genes 10,000 years ago to follow us around and eat our pizza crusts. So it's an impressively invasive bird and one of the most widespread birds pretty much anywhere on the planet. So you will definitely hear this pretty much anytime you walk outside and you hear a bird. The second bird is the American robin. So the American robin is my state bird here in Michigan. And one of the things that I wait for in just like the biggest anticipation for spring, because its song is so melodious and very tonal, that to me as a musician, it just sort of like thrills me to hear, especially when there's like tens of them around and just all singing around me. So a very unique bird with a very unique sound, but also very common. Our third bird was the chickadee, another very famous bird. And the chickadee is a very impressive threat detection system. So based on the number of chickadee-dee-dee-dees it puts at the end of its call, the dee-dee-dee, that can communicate to other animals what other warnings or things to be, dangers out there in the forest. It's kind of funny when I'm walking by these buddies, like with my dog, I kind of count the D's, like, you know, how much does this guy like me today? Right. But again, a very iconic call. I kind of like the chickadee dee 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 onomatopoeia. That's what I kind of use. And then finally, the house finch. Another very, very, very common bird, throughout North America, and other parts of the world too. And this one I think is unique for the number of syllables it has, again, up to 46, like it says on the screen. And this is my DJ bird, because DJ bird here likes to chop up those syllables into this really wonky sort of like scratchy beat, at least to my ears. So that's how I kind of remember the finch. But those are our four birds. I'll play them again super, super quick. House sparrow. That's the American robin with its tonal sort of call. Chickadee with its chickadee-dee-dee. And the house finch with its stream of syllables, right? Now, in the sake of time, I'm not gonna have anyone share their work. With more time, it might have been fun to see what everyone came up with for these four birds. Maybe you did some cool doodles on the side or came up with some clever things. But I wanna wrap up part one here and open it up for questions in a second. Just to wrap things up, I just wanna talk about why I picked these birds. So I picked them because they're common. I picked birds that most people in North America would probably be able to hear, and birds that are very like widespread. Now, the interesting thing to me is that as I was doing this research and researching these bird calls and the regions they live in, especially on the Audubon website, one thing I came across, the Audubon website actually has a really good tracker for how these birds will do with climate change. And you know, the thing is, this house sparrow is gonna be fine. Like, it's an invasive species. It's kind of conquered the planet. And so if the planet warms by 3 degrees Celsius, which is one of the more extreme possible futures we have for climate change, if we let things go unmitigated, this bird's gonna be fine. As a matter of fact, it's gonna be gaining range in its habitat. But we can't say the same thing about, for example, a hermit thrush, which is my favorite songbird and something that's very special to me here in Michigan. It's something I hear when I travel up to northern Michigan to visit my parents or in the UP. that bird's going to be lost, even if we warm the planet a degree and a half Celsius or 2.7 degrees Fahrenheit. So for me, this sort of is an overlap with the idea of climate justice, right? The idea that climate change disproportionately affects people who are already disproportionately affected by other climate and environmental disasters, right? Black communities, poor people, people who live in Pacific Islands, and other poor people who live across the world. And I find it interesting that there's a corollary in the world of birds, and that they will be experiencing the same disproportionate effects. So I think about, you know, the quote we heard at the beginning with Kurt Cobain telling us birds are telling us the truth. And I feel like this is a dire truth that they're trying to tell us, right? That they're in trouble and we are also in trouble. And it's disproportionately going to affect people who are already hurting the most, right? And yes, Tansy, great question. I'll take that as our first question. Look at that. You were like just ahead of the curve. Yes, it's the Audubon website. I can even pull it up really quick and show you the American Robin here. So for example, this is the Audubon.org, sorry, website. And by the way, if you don't know Audubon, they're a very, very, very famous and old bird organization. They have one of the best websites for looking at birds because they have the range here. They have sounds that you can use to like double check your ear. Like, oh, I heard a bird. I think it's a robin. Let me go here and check. But then down here, it shows you what the impacts of climate change are going to have on this particular bird. So we can see if we raise the planet 1.5 degrees Celsius, a lot of areas in this sort of like, you know, upper south and upper Midwest, lower Midwest here are going to lose this bird, right? So yeah, Tansy, that's a great question. And I'll just send you all this American Robin site in the chat, so you can kind of go there and see some other birds if you use a search bar and check out how climate change will affect each individual bird. Yeah, again, I think the Audubon has done a really great job of that messaging and putting out literature and resources for people to see how climate change is going to directly affect birds. And this is one example of that, right? So Tansy, again, ahead of the curve, great question there. It's like you predicted my slide there. How do you know that? Does anyone else have any sort of question they want to throw out there before we jump into part two? Cool. All right, everyone. So that was the end of part one, where we sort of built your skills up. So now we're going to jump into part two, where we put them to work. Good luck. Okay. Before I get to this question, Tansy, I'll answer your question really quick in the chat. Great question from your partner. The audio came from a collection of, Tansy, by the way, in the chat's asking where I got my audio clips. A lot of these are from the Audubon, but I also use the Cornell Institute of Ornithology. They have a lot of great audio. And then later on in the presentation, which we probably won't get to, I use some of my own field recordings. I didn't use a lot of these in this presentation because a lot of them aren't as clear as the Audubon and the Cornell Institute. But yeah, really quickly, if you're curious, ornithology, I think I spelled that right. And yes, Kit, oh my gosh, you're totally right. Yeah, they are the best wildlife cams. Thank you for that, Kit. They are the best, oh my gosh. So there you go, Tansy. There are a couple resources for you. Audubon and the Cornell Institute. Great question from your partner. So here we go. What are birds? Seems like a silly question, right? And by the way, you don't have to answer these questions. These are rhetorical, right? It's a good question, but maybe a simple question, but I think it's worth clarifying. So in this presentation, I'm mainly going to be talking about songbirds, and we have been talking about songbirds. And that's about half of all the birds in the world. There are about 10,000 different species of birds. And I'm not sure if you knew this, I didn't for the longest time. Birds are dinosaurs. Very cool, right? They're direct descendants of the dinosaur lineage. And of course, some of you would look at this Archaeopteryx, it's called, on my screen and go, well, yeah, of course, it has feathers. It has wings. Of course, that's a bird dinosaur thing, right? But the really cool thing about dinosaurs evolving into birds is it wasn't the feathers, it wasn't the wings, it was the size. So because one particular lineage of dinosaurs started shrinking, that kind of started the evolutionary process for birds to emerge. So it's actually the smallness of those dinosaurs that made birds. Pretty cool, right? Now let's talk about how do birds sing. And equally as important, I think, how do humans sing? And what are the similarities and differences? So really quick, I want you all to find your larynx. Okay. Now, to save us all the guttural choir here, keep yourselves muted. Please keep yourselves muted. We don't need to hear your, that I'm heavy about to do. But if you don't know where your larynx is, it's your voice box. It's kind of right beneath your chin, just above your Adam's apple here. Just kind of do this really quick for me. Take your fingers, put it right beneath your chin here on your throat and just go. And if you did that right, you should have felt a vibration there. That's your larynx. Those are your vocal cords or your vocal folds. And basically what's happening is air is traveling from your lungs through your trachea, your throat, and those muscles are chopping the air into certain patterns that create sounds and music and phonemes that create words and sentences, right? It's an incredible set of muscles that are very delicate. I mean, it says here that they're the size of a penny, right? And yet they have so much range and so much flexibility to do so many things. I mean, it really is phenomenal what, for example, like an opera star can do with their voice, right? To project to like the back of a concert hall, right? But it's got nothing on the syrinx. So interestingly enough, a bird does have a larynx, but it also has a syrinx. And the syrinx is at the bottom of its trachea, right where the lungs split into two, which means there's one set for each lung, which means, and this is mind-blowing, birds are polyphonic. They can sing two things at the same time, which is literally something we can't do because we don't have that mechanism, right? Even tube and throat singers are just manipulating overtones. They're not literally singing two things at the same time like a bird is. They don't have two sets of muscles, right? And if you all blink your eyes with me, those birds can manipulate those muscles in their syrinx 100 times faster than that, which is just mind-blowing, right? So of course, having two sets of these muscles and that sort of flexible virtuosity to move them 100 times faster than we blink our eyes gives them an enormous set of sonic possibilities. And one example of this is the northern cardinal, a very popular bird on the eastern half of North America here. It can rip through these sort of octave sweeps in a tenth of a second. So as an example, I have a sonogram here. Just listen to how it whips through these notes here. So again, that's because of the syrinx. It starts the lower notes on one half of its syrinx, and then the other half of its syrinx finishes the higher octave. Cool, right? Okay, it's time for our first bird quiz. It looks like we're gonna get two today. I had four planned, but of course, ran out of time because I stuffed too much good stuff into this presentation. So for this first bird quiz, it's just a refresher. I'm digging out the four birds we learned in part one and developed sonic tokens for, and I want to see if you can remember them. So annotate, put it in the chat, whichever you feel comfortable with. Tell me what this first bird is. What is it? Oh, Milani's got a good guess. Yep, Kit's picking up on the onomatopoeia we talked about, right? That's my trick. And by the way, if anyone needs these, I'll just kind of throw those at the bottom there. Here's bird number two. By the way, I'm not going to say the right answers yet. I'll let you keep guessing. Here's number two. Some guesses out there for number two already. Okay. Yeah, hopefully those sonic tokens are working for you, right? Here's number three. Oh, I love seeing these beautiful annotations just flying across the screen. It's gorgeous chaos and I love it. This is perfect. Okay, and here's our last bird. Okay. So I think we all did pretty well here. So I'm just gonna go ahead and whip through these answers really quick. First bird was our chickadee, chickadee-dee-dee-dee. Our house finch, the multisyllabic bird there. The house sparrow. I think of this, by the way, as like basic bird, like chirp, chirp, chirp. That's kind of how I remember it. It's very generic, very basic. And then we have our American robin, the very tonal sort of bird that kind of does this cheer up, cheerily. It's one of the onomatopoeias that the Audubon suggests. So congratulations all. I saw you did pretty good down there, but we're not done. Be prepared for another quiz on your way out here. But first, let's talk about how a bird brain works really quick. Okay. So birds are vocal learners, which is a very small subset of the animal kingdom. You know, we have dolphins, bats, sea lions, whales, and us humans. It basically means that a bird can hear a sound, interpret that sound in their brain, and then recreate something like that sound, right? Kind of like how we can sort of talk to each other. Like we can hear what we're saying and then communicate something back, right? And beyond this though, bird science gets even crazier when we start talking about things like parrots, because not only do most birds have brain centers that kind of overlap with human language brain centers, they're very like similar in the way that they process language, that humans and us, sorry, birds and humans process language. Parrots have another whole like part of their brain that hears outside of its species. So a quick example here is this bird, Alex the parrot. He was like this very famous parrot that was like exceptionally bright. He would invent words. So for example, he came up with the term binary because he couldn't say the word apple because the bird doesn't have lips, it can't do a P. So instead of saying apple, it said binary, a cross between a banana and cherry because it tasted like a banana and looked like a cherry to the bird. Pretty remarkable for a bird to invent language, right? And then I'm just going to end with this before our final quiz that I'm going to throw at you, the lyrebird. This sort of is like the culmination of all that we've learned about the bird so far. The lyrebird is probably the most wicked mimic out there in the avian kingdom, but it's also probably the most adept with its syrinx, as you're about to see. So sit back and watch this video of Sir David Attenborough, for those of you who know who he is, explain the lyrebird. This is an incredible clip that never gets old for me. And then we'll do our final quiz, everybody.
In his attempt to outsing his rivals, incorporates other sounds that he hears in the forest. That was a camera shutter. And again. And now a camera with a motor drive. And that's a car alarm. And now the sounds of foresters and their chainsaws working nearby.
Yeah, so I don't know if this is what you were getting at, Joanna, but I've literally had like students before say like, no, you're lying. Like, you put sound clips over this video clip. That bird is not doing that. But it is. And every time I see this clip, I've probably seen it like hundreds of times. It just blows my mind. Like, how can a creature do that? Right? I mean, it's manipulating the muscles in its syrinx and using its sort of brain activity, the sort of synthesized sounds that it's hearing, and reproduce them. It just, come on, right? So that was the lyrebird. I just had to show you that before you all left, right? But we have our final bird quiz of the night here. And this is gonna be a little bit more like real life here, okay? So pretend like you're on a walk. And for the next 30 seconds, you're gonna hear five things, five birds around you. And so your job while you're out on this walk is to see how quickly you can identify all five. Okay. So again, 30 second clip, pretend like you're out walking for 30 seconds and you hear these five things. Let's see if you can figure out what they are. So that was quick, right? But that's real life. I mean, that's what happens when you're out walking, you're really trying to listen to these birds. They come at you fast sometimes. And so you have to be just kind of ready to go. So let's see how you did. So this was the order of events, if you caught them all. So we started with the sound of a robin. Right there, that's a robin. Chickadee at 10 seconds. That's our sparrow. Our finch right there. Trick question, a robin and a chickadee, so the intersperse there. Because that happens, right? Birds can chirp at the same time. So, and sometimes when you're first out there trying to learn, it can be very confusing when you're hearing like all this information coming at you. So I wanted to give you like a real life sort of thing that could happen to you on your bird, sonic bird walk out there, right? So everyone, I have much, much, much more I could talk about here, but not nearly enough time tonight to share it. Joanna and I just agreed that we could go a little bit over time. So I would say if you're willing to stay another 10 minutes for some extra information, great. If you want to leave now because it's the end of our hour, I'm not going to hold you back. So if you have to leave, take care. See you later. But if you want to stick around for 10 more minutes, stick around with me because I have a few more things to share. And maybe you can take my impossible bird quiz if you're interested. Okay, so real quick, I'm just going to fly through this information here. Why do birds sing is such a deep question. So I'm just going to hit the surface here. So a typical scientist will say two things. The scientist will say, well, it's defending its territory and it's trying to get a mate. Those are the only two reasons why birds sing. But hold on a sec. Female birds sing. And this is something that the scientific world has ignored, and that's due to a lot of biases in the scientific world. The fact that science is predominated by men who would ignore something like the field of bird song done by females, and also men who live in the Western world, i.e. America and Europe, who don't really care about birds in the Southern Hemisphere, where female bird song is prevalent. So when you add this to the equation, well, wait, why would a female bird sing if the males are the ones doing the mating and the females don't really have to protect the territory, right? And this is kind of like a field that's only recently gotten attention. And so scientists are still trying to figure this out. Why would female birds sing? And it kind of pokes holes in the old arguments, right? So we're slowly trying to combat these biases in the scientific world and get to the bottom of this question. And then you can answer this question from the side of an artist. There's a great book by the musician David Rothenberg, who asked this question, literally, Why Birds Sing, it's the name of his book. And he floats all these questions that he has as an artist listening to bird song that sort of give you pause as to, again, this the typical line that scientists give, mating and territory. Like, for example, does a mate really have time to listen to a brown thrasher who has over 1,000 different songs? Like, does having 1,000 songs really give you a mating advantage, right? So again, because of this, it's gotten me to sort of question, like, why do birds sing? And could it even be like sort of for an aesthetic, does it have aesthetic beauty to them? And what do we even know about the way they process like their own singing, right? And it really gets at the question of what's the sort of dividing line between nature and music, right? Because we kind of think of music as a human domain, but I have since started to question that after learning so much about birds and the way they interpret music. Big philosophical question that we could probably spend a whole other presentation on, but I just wanted to kind of float that out there for y'all to think on your own. And then I'm gonna skip this bird quiz and go to this question really quick before I give you all the impossible bird quiz. Is it gonna be fun? What's the relationship between bird song and music, which is the whole point of this presentation, right? So I have three quick things to share for you, then we'll do our lovely impossible quiz. Mozart had a pet starling. This starling was picked up by him in a bird shop because it sang back one of his tunes to him. And this was a tune that like Mozart hadn't finished. Like he probably walked into the bird shop, whistled it once, walked out, and then the bird remembered it weeks later. So then Mozart bought that bird. Whoa. And then as David Rothenberg says in his book, Mozart might have actually changed one of the notes in the melody because the bird did. Like the bird fixed Mozart's melody. So think about that. A bird fixed one of like, you know, the greatest composers who has ever lived, like its melody. Like the bird was like, hey, Mozart, no, it should be this note. Pretty cool, right? And I shared this story to illustrate the relationship between birds and composers goes back a long time, right? For hundreds of years, birds and composers have had a symbiotic relationship, I feel like. And no one better illustrates this than Olivier Messiaen. He was a French composer who was a remarkably good ornithologist. His bird song transcriptions are unparalleled, I think, in terms of the way he heard musical things in the bird song and transcribed it into sheet music. And for example, I'll just give one quick one here. He took the sound of the Northern Cardinal and turned it into this piano piece. And again, he didn't just transcribe like one note. Like a lot of composers will just take like one note and use that as the basis of their like song. He grabs like the timbre of that bird too. Like he gets at like a deeper sound in that Cardinal song that I don't think any other composer really has gotten to before. So again, if you want to kind of go to the source of like bird song and music, go to Olivier Messiaen here. He's by far your source for that. And then before we wrap things up with our final bird quiz, I just want to float out my absolute favorite bird probably in the world. The hermit thrush here. And there's a fascinating scientific study on the hermit thrush that shows it actually sings with overtones from an overtone series. And these scientists actually figured that this bird hears these overtones naturally, like in nature. Somehow it's grabbing these like overtones, hearing them, processing them, and then singing them back out into nature. And some now think that maybe perhaps human song is like its origin point is in birdsong, like because the birds heard the overtones first and then we just copied them. So that's just a really quick slide through the relationship between birdsong and music. I could go on and talk about all my favorite examples in like recorded music and written music history, but real quick, I'm going to really challenge you all now. Okay, so there are some curveballs here. I'm not gonna lie to you. There are some really hard curveballs here, but this is what it's really like when you're out birding and listening. See if you can figure out what you're hearing here. This is your final bird quiz, and this is the impossible one because, yeah, it's impossible. So that was a toughie, but this is kind of what it feels like when you're out there like really trying to parse things out sometimes. You get these curveballs thrown at you and you're just like, what was that? What was that, right? So just really quick, and if I had more time, I'd play it again, but I want to cut things short here. The first thing you heard was a sparrow and a robin, same time. The second thing you heard was a chickadee. It was kind of this, but it's kind of one of the body double things, the mimic things, where a chickadee has more than one call. It's not just chickadee, dee, 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 dee. And then we had a finch and some blue jays. Yeah, clever, Joanna. It's all lyrebird, right? we had a finch and two blue jays mixed in there. I figured I'd call back to a bird we learned earlier. And then there's the minor bird, which was none of the above. But that's an important skill to know when you're out there birding. You can know like all these birds and then you hear one that you're like, I don't know. And you gotta sort of admit that and be like, okay, back on the quest here, get out my Audubon and like start searching for sounds. What is that bird, right? And again, it helps you kind of, when you can rule it out as I don't know what that is, it helps you hear the others better, right? So that's an important skill when you're out there listening for your birds, right? So, all right, everyone, I'm going to skip to the very end here and just say thank you. That was a lot to throw at you all in like the space of just over an hour, but hopefully this idea that Birdsong is this amazing sonic puzzle for you just outside your window or your door that you can participate in is probably the best thing I can steal with you today. And hopefully I gave you a little bit of techniques to allow you to do that. So thank you all. And I really appreciate you being here. Really appreciate you being here for this workshop. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Andy. And thank you, everybody. Just a little side note that this will be available. This whole presentation will be available on our website. And just stay tuned to our Instagram to, yes, you can email us. And I will leave our website here for everybody. And our Instagram handle. All right, here. Perfect. And perfect. Alrighty. Well, thank you so much for everybody for tuning in and for participating. And thank you so much, especially to Andy. Gonna give you jazz hands for an amazing workshop where I know if we had more time, it would be even more spectacular. And all right, have a great day. And here's to bird songing.
Bye all. Thanks for coming.